All right. Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome again to Fusion 360 Increment Webinar Course Series. Thank you for joining today's session on Fusion 360 Simulation. Sanjeev Ghosh has joined as our expert for today, and he will share some amazing best practices of simulation in Fusion 360 work environment. Hi, Sanjeev.
Thank you for giving your valuable time for this webinar.
Over to you.
Hey, thank you, Varun. Thank you so much. So let me share my screen now. So thanks, Varun. Really excited to be part of this series, and welcome everyone to today's session. Today we are going to talk about Fusion 360 simulation and how to get started, and what are some of the elements that are included. What are some of the things that you can do? So the agenda will look something like this. A very simple agenda, just 3 points out there. And I will be introducing you to what is simulation in Fusion 360. What are some of the key features? And then we'll see some examples with a live demo. So that's the intent and the way I want to carry out this session. So Fusion 360 simulation is powered by Autodesk Nastrens. So for you, for the people out there who are familiar with mechanical simulation, Nastrens is not a very unknown name. Nastrens has been there for more than 35 years in the industry. Essentially, Nastrens stands for NASA Structural Analysis, and it was first designed as a code to solve problems for the National Aeronautical Space Agency of the USA. So they created the code, and subsequently they went on to commercialize the code. There are other companies who have a Nastrens version from the same commercial code, and Autodesk a couple of years back made an acquisition of one of those Nastrens codes from a company called NEI. So this is the same Nastrens that is part of Fusion 360, and it can do a couple of great things out there, starting from the most basic linear static stress analysis. So I'm going to have some assumptions here. I'm going to assume that people on the call at least have some orientation in terms of finite element analysis. May not be detailed. In fact, to be frank, even I am not a postgraduate in analysis. I have not done anything great in terms of my background in and knowledge. It has been on the go, and I have captured as much knowledge as I have been working for the years that I have been. And I am a BE mechanical. I am a mechanical engineer, essentially, to just give you a little bit of my background. But the terms that you see here, for example, linear static analysis, model frequency. If you have been using any 3D modeling tool and an associated analysis software, these terms are definitely very familiar. So linear static analysis perhaps is the most common form of analysis that we can do. I'm going to show you some examples, but we can also deal with some advanced problems such as model frequency. Of course, is not so advanced, but going ahead, thermal stress, things like structural buckling. Now, everything, the example that I'm going to show you perhaps is a very good example where, a linear static stress analysis will not solve the problem, because a problem like that, if I apply linear static stress, it's not going to give the right result. So buckling is sometimes I might have to apply for a problem which you're going to see in one of my examples. Shape optimization. I'm sure you have also been hearing of some great things that are there in Fusion. You might have heard of terms like generative design, and I'm sure a lot of you are familiar and have seen and hear a couple of other speakers in this session who perhaps have already spoken or are going to speak about generative design. But generative design, although it's a very advanced method of solving problems in a very simple way, a precursor to that would be something known as shape optimization, where I do have a shape which I want to further optimize, I want to reduce weight, and so on. So that is what shape optimization. Then we have the elements of structural buckling, nonlinear static analysis, and even a very powerful simulation method known as the event simulation. Now, all these analysis types perhaps are there in almost a lot of these tools out there. But what we are trying to do is we are trying to make it easy for you to access these tools through Fusion 360. And not just access, even the part where we really solve or the actual solving of the problem once it has been defined. You know, that is an area which is which can be really troubling when it comes to usage of hardware and hardware resources. So all of the problem solving in Fusion 360, some of it definitely can be solved with your local resources, because for everything you don't need a very high computing capacity. But there are other problems, you know, which although they can be solved on your hardware, the RAM that you have, the processing power that you have, but definitely they might take a while, a couple of hours to more than a day sometimes. And that is where the engineer who is working on the problem sometimes really gets frustrated. And after having spent a lot of time in solving a problem which takes maybe 6 or 7 hours or maybe more than that to solve, and to realize that the results show that a change is needed to be made, which means I need to make a change and again revalidate, it's really frustrating, believe me. So what we have done is we have provided the ability to define your problem in the solution in Fusion 360, but the burden of the solving is taken care by cloud. So that is what I'm going to also talk about, show you the examples that I'm going to show you. I will be using Cloud Solve. And then not every problem or every design that comes to you is solved exactly the way it is designed, because you know, for solving there might be some elements that are definitely not necessary and are not going to add any value to the solving process. So there is always the need to adapt the design for the purpose of solving, which means that, you know, there might be some quick changes that are needed to be made. So there is a simplify workspace that helps you do just that. And then there is the way to compare the results. So, you know, when you want to do multiple analysis, you also want to compare results between the various outcomes that have been given by the software. So there's a very easy way to compare the outcomes as well. So some of the key features. So although, as I said, Fusion 360 can do everything that an advanced simulation software can is expected to do, the emphasis is we are emphasizing here is on how easy it is to use and adopt. And once I get into the real demo, when I introduce you to the interface, what really you will find there is, you know, you don't really need to be a rocket scientist to understand some of the concepts of getting started with simulation in Fusion 360. It's been made very simplistic, easy to understand. Results are as accurate as any other powerful FEA solver. So although it's very advanced, it can solve very, very complex problems. To be able to use it and get results is not the challenge out here. It's something which is very easy to use. As I was talking about the Simplify workspace, a small self-running video out here explaining, you know, how I can really make up for the model to be able to solve things quickly. So now this is a very quick example of a printed circuit board with a lot of elements. And when I mean a lot of elements, every element, every small part out there in the printed circuit board might be a separate geometry. Each one might be having features such as fillets, chamfers. As in, if I were to count the number of faces and the number of edges and perhaps vertices, it will be running in a few lakhs even for this small component. So in the Simplify workspace, I can really make it simple and easy to solve. Now, why I need to do this is because I want to solve fast, and I don't want to waste my computing power to in areas which are not going to really add value or contribute to my analysis. So there are areas that need to be modified because I know that this is an area that is not getting affected by the loads, and I will definitely want to simplify them, because the more the number of faces, the more the number of edges and disconnected elements, it is going to be broken down into many smaller elements that are really going to be that is going to be a very huge number, and it is definitely going to take a very long time to solve that. So simplify workspace definitely helps you to make that easy by allowing you to quickly simplifying things without really bothering how it was modeled, in what software it was created. Irrespective of any software it might be coming in from, even of course designed in Fusion 360 itself, or as an input it could be coming in from any absolutely any tool, such as Autodesk Inventor, it could be SolidWorks, Solid Edge, or absolutely any other tool. So it doesn't differentiate between the geometry and allows you to solve or allows you to simplify with ease. And as I said, and again, I'm going to repeat, it is powered by Autodesk Nastran, which is hosted on the cloud. Now, why I'm emphasizing on cloud here is because the cloud has the capacity to host many processors and carry out calculations parallelly across various processors. So there's a lot of potential to do parallel computing on the cloud. It is a supercomputer out there. We have now given or allowed our users of Fusion 360 the power of a supercomputer on the cloud to be able to solve problems very quickly without having to really worry about the hardware they have, or really having to invest in the hardware needed to solve very complex problems. All that burden is taken on by the cloud on one hand, and it is with the accuracy and the robustness of the Autodesk Nastran solver. So both elements, one is the Autodesk Nastran solver and it being hosted on the cloud, two very complementing factors allow the Fusion 360 users to solve very complex problems within a very short time. Now, short is a relative term. I am comparing this to if I was solving the problem on a desktop as compared to the time it takes on the cloud. It's a very huge time saving. I will be taking on questions, or maybe I have colleagues who can parallelly answer questions. I believe I see some questions on the Q&A panel. I'll get
Sanjay,
to those.
So, usually what we do is we do a 15-minute Q&A in the end of the webinar.
Sure.
Meanwhile, absolutely. Me and Anand will also take some questions. So please feel free to go with your flow.
Absolutely. Thank you, Varun. Thanks, Anand.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Great. So you see, I'm not alone in this presentation. I have colleagues who are helping out there to really address all your needs. So, again, more emphasis on cloud. One of the biggest things that I would really put as the winning point here is simultaneous solves. In a conventional desktop-based solving scenario, it is very difficult to solve many problems at the same time, which means that I solve a problem, I wait for the results to be thrown at me, I review the results, and I go on to make necessary changes. The changes could be that of geometry, it could be those of boundary conditions, or it could be that of material alternatives. So, and then I make these changes, I solve again, and then it's an iterative process of reviewing results and making relevant changes, and perhaps at the end taking all the results together maybe and comparing them and deciding on the best possible option. Now, this is when I'm doing it serially, this is something that will take definitely a long time, and it can be quite a draining process. But on the cloud, since we are talking of parallel computing, we are talking of parallel processing. On a cloud, we can definitely solve many problems, many alternatives right at the same time. I can say I want to analyze with material A, B, C, D, E, F, G, maybe many materials, and solve the same problem for all these materials and look at all the results together. So I can do that on the cloud. Not really possible, or really, I would say rather very difficult on the local machine. Again, the scope and size and the number of problems that we can solve on a local machine is limited by your hardware. On the cloud, it is a multi-core cloud server, and you can solve as many problems that, as you want. So it lets you solve independently of the local hardware, and even it's not something that is internet hungry. Internet is only required when the problem is delivered to the cloud. At that moment, you can absolutely switch off your machine and or carry out with any other work. If you are already working, you can just switch off the software and invoke something else and continue to work on something else. And the moment this problem is ready with a solution, you will get notified by an email. And absolutely, the last point, the maintenance costs. You need to, so the moment you there's a new version of a software coming in, there is need for upgrading your hardware, and hardware is never perpetual. Hardware has to be renewed over a course of time, whereas you don't need to really maintain the cloud. You just perhaps have to rent out the power of the cloud to solve your problem. So the maintenance of the hardware is absolutely not your headache with the cloud. You continue to use your perhaps not so powerful machine and leave the upgrade of the cloud to Autodesk. So it's a very low entry model, and you can pay as you go. So just pay for the cloud when you have to solve a problem. You don't have to always own a very powerful machine and not be using it all the time, so that as in maybe you don't really save on money there. You have idle time that is a waste of money. That doesn't definitely happen on the cloud. Now, problems, you saw the type of problems that we can solve, and then there is the aspect of materials. So as I said, Fusion 360 based on Nastran is not just a beautified solver. It is a very, very advanced software, very, very advanced solver that can also handle advanced material like elastoplastics, like hyperelastic materials and temperature dependent materials. So it can absolutely solve the most advanced problems with being able to properly define the type of material that is necessary for a particular application. Now, event simulation, something very, very interesting. I would say that this is a very, very niche area. Why? Because here we are trying to simulate very short events that occur across a duration of a very minuscule time, perhaps micro or milliseconds, which involve changes in geometry as the analysis is happening. The deformations could be large, and that they may also involve motion. Some examples could be impact and contact test, drop test, snap fits. These are some examples of event simulation where there is a burst of perhaps energy being transmitted on a moving component with a large deflection that happens momentarily, and then there is a rebound that happens. So a good example could be a snap fit, and we have seen snap fits almost everywhere. Simple products to the very famous buckle on our back sacks, they are snap fits where there are two components going inside each other. And the kind of functionality that we need to solve such a problem are being able to restrict the solve to the element that is under deflection by specifying what are rigid bodies. Now there is a movement, hence there is a element of contact condition throughout the motion, throughout the movement of the moving part. One part perhaps will be kept stationary and the other part is moving. So throughout that movement, there is an element of contact that has to be dealt with dynamically. So it's not a static contact we are talking about. We are talking of a contact that evolves as the simulation progresses. So automatic contact, deletion and addition of elements. I would say not addition, but deletion of elements. Whenever there is a rupture, there are elements that are removed and you can really simulate a physical rupture, physical failure. Usually what we are used to in conventional analysis methods when it comes to static stress, linear static stress, is looking at the values of stress and I would say strain, displacement by way of color codes. But here we are able to simulate the complete rupture of a component. So this is, I would say, a very advanced simulation that is definitely a part of Fusion 360. So Varun, I'm seeing some chat on the audio. Is there any issue with audio or video by any chance? I'm just checking.
No, it's good. There was some issue previously, but I think this is resolved now. This is all good.
Okay. Thank you. The next piece, again, something very advanced. And similar to event simulation, which is a time-dependent analysis, here in shape approximation, we are able to modify, or rather we are able to come up with the outcome that is much more lighter as compared to what we would have designed with our conventional wisdom. So what I'm not saying that our conventional wisdom is wrong, but you know, we are definitely, I would say, clouded by the paradigms that we work with. We look at how things have been done traditionally. We are influenced by that. And there are many other factors that, you know, allow us to think in a certain way. So here in shape optimization, definitely the part that the software solves for you is it takes your existing design and makes it much more lighter, allowing for maximizing stiffness or minimizing mass. So there are various ways in this can be solved, but the outcome that you get is a much more optimized design, which means you have a lighter component, perhaps a better strength because the geometry is slightly altered, and overall it gives you greater efficiency when you are having such a component or a part that is optimized, which is part of a moving assembly. So which means that less power required or less energy required to move assembly or subassembly within a larger assembly. So many advantages. And again, this is a compute intensive task, so this can definitely be handled much more simplistically and faster on the cloud. So now I'm going to take you through a few examples, starting with an example of structural buckling, which will look something like this. A very, very simple thing, but I'm going to, as we go through this, I'm going to sort of explain you how we approach the problem and why this is something that is more valuable as compared to some of the basic analysis types, which you might be familiar with. So now let me take you to Fusion 360. So I hope you can see my Fusion 360 screen. Just a quick validation, Varun.
Yes, this is looking good.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So a simple object, perhaps, absolutely a kind of table. Of course, it's not aesthetically, definitely not aesthetically appealing. But, you know, it's a representative model of a chair, perhaps. I believe it could be a plastic chair, it could be something made of wood or perhaps metal, but let's consider this is something which is made of plastic. And as of now, ignore these small elements out there. I'm going to switch on something known as capture design history. Now, if you have been attending the previous Fusion seminars and perhaps a lot more to come going ahead, you will realize that it's so easy to manipulate objects. And I, you know, without even thinking where the feature was, in which part it was, I could easily eliminate or modify or remove those elements. And it's a part of my history. So I can always roll back to that previous thing. But the point being, I really did not bother, or if I were using a desktop based software that was more dependent on parameters and features and the feature tree, feature history, I would really have to figure out which is the part, activate that part, go inside that, look at the feature tree and go back to that sketch, make changes or suppress it and so on. Many steps involved. Here I could simply select that face and say delete. The delete on my keyboard really helped me do that. So yes, that was not anything to do with simulation. It was being able to easily manipulate the geometry. Now, I really want to find out, perhaps this is a good design and maybe it solves my problem. But before manufacturing, I really want to find out whether these legs as well as this top out here, are they good enough for holding a certain amount of weight? That is what I want to find out. Now, how do I perhaps do that? Perhaps. Okay. Let's look at a simple example. Is okay. So how do I approach my design? I have this area where I select my workspace. Currently, I am in my design workspace where I absolutely have all the elements of being able to modify this. Now, if I were to modify this and increase the length of this, okay, so now in order to, you know, find out its functional characteristics, what do I do? So there are many workspaces out there. The one workspace that we are going to look at and the topic of the day is simulation. So I'm going to go to the simulation workspace. Now, as we progress, as we look at things, what you're going to really find out here is, let me in fact go back look at how this would look initially when I open my software for the first time. Okay. This is the window that is perhaps prompted when you create a new study and it asks you what is the study that you want to do. And one of the easiest study to do for me is this one out here, which is the static stress. So I'm going to quickly create a study which will allow me to do a static stress analysis. Now, I'm currently in this static stress analysis study that allows me to define my problem. Now, how do I define my problem? Do I need to really simplify this? I believe this is simple enough and I cannot simplify this further. You know, there are no complicated elements. It's a very boxy design, not something that I would do if I were to design my table for myself. But yes, nevertheless, we have this model and I would say that this is something that we are stuck with, and I'm going to go ahead and define something. For example, I'm going to define my material. Okay. The first thing I'm going to do is define my material.
Hey, Sanjeev, a quick request. Somebody suggested, can you please switch off your data panel, the left one, so they can see the entire screen?
Hey, thank you for bringing that out, which means that a lot of people are familiar with the data panel as well.
Yeah. Right.
Great. Thanks for the session and I really appreciate that. So, by the way, people who are not familiar with the data panel, that is an area where collaboration happens, all your data resides, and unlike the usual software that we are used to in Windows, you are not able to search for a file designed by Fusion 360 in a Windows Explorer. You see it all in the data panel. So all my data resides here, and all my collaborators happen to be in this area. So, well, I've closed that for now, and we have maximized our area of work.
It looks good now.
Yeah. So what I'm going to do next is, you know, as I designed this, or whoever did this design, perhaps the default material that is assigned, you know, there's a default material, there's a default that is set is steel. So I want to change that. So I'm going to simply do a select all out here. Select, and I'm going to override the material. I'm going to select just plastic. Of course, what plastic, I'm not really bothered for this particular exercise as of now. So I selected plastic for one, and since I selected all, it was assigned to all the elements. So everything is now a plastic material. So if you look at this, there is a sequence in which these icons have been laid. First was the simplify, because most of the times when you get a complicated geometry, you would first do simplification. Then once that is done, you move on to assigning materials. The next part that I'm going to do is assign constraints or fix this. Now, I'm doing this the way I would do it without the knowledge of analysis, because I'm doing what is the most easiest part. I'm doing a linear static stress analysis, and I'm going to fix this part here, you know, which is perhaps the one that is touching the ground, or, you know, that is how this is kept on the ground. And I just say okay. Well, I see small icons that tell me this is fixed. And now I'm going to apply loads. Now, before I apply loads, let us look at how we can apply loads in Fusion 360. So, you know, this the ways Fusion 360 treats a model, it's a solid model, and we need to look at elements of the solid model that can be used to apply forces, constraints, or various other boundary conditions. Now, here I can select a face, or I can select an edge, or I can select a vertice. So this is how I can define or specify a boundary condition, such as a structural load or even my constraints. So if I look at this, and if I see that I am being able to apply a force on the entire body out there, well, okay, this is okay, but is this right? I am not very sure, you know, because if I am keeping something on this table, it won't be occupying the entire space the way I applied the force, maybe. So this is not really realistic. So I want to solve the problem maybe with my limited knowledge of how things should be solved really. Now, you know, I go on to solve, and in this solve there is a pre-check which tells me if my problem has been properly defined or not. So it shows an exclamation mark out there which indicates that the problem is not really properly defined. So I go to pre-check. It tells me that the degrees of freedom are not completely provided. Okay, so here, click here to select the degrees of freedom. And if I see here, it shows that everything is red, which means that they are all free. Now, why is this? Well, since we are not speaking to each other, I'll just tell you why this is. Because we have fixed these small pieces out there. But frankly, these are all different parts. This part out here is not connected to this. It's just modeled there. But there is no connection. If I pull this and move this guy, I am perhaps going to see that this can be moved away. So they are all modeled. They look to be connected, but actually they are not glued to each other. They are not welded to each other. There is no connection between them. Now, how a connection can be specified in a solving is by means of something known as contacts. Now, I'm not going to go deep, very deep out here. For the people who just want to know contacts, you know, when there are two faces that are touching each other, I need to specify whether these two faces in the circumstance of being applied a pressure force, are they going to go within each other? Are they going to slide on each other? Or are they perfectly bonded to each other? As in, they are going to move with respect to each other as if welded or glued to each other. So this is a very rough definition of a contact. So I'm going to do our automatic contacts out here. And there is this resolution that is given. Now, why is this resolution? When I'm saying two faces are in contact, there may be a small gap, there may be a modeling error, and I don't know where this data is coming from and what software has been used. So maybe the designer has made a mistake, he has left a gap somewhere, but I want to totally ignore those gaps. So I specify a resolution, you know, or a minimum value where I can say that this is the gap that I want to ignore, and anything within this value is I'm going to consider as connected to each other or touching each other. So it is going to create or generate something known as contact sets, or two surfaces or sets of two surfaces that are in contact with each other. So I'm going to generate them. It's automatic done. I can do it manually by trying to figure out the contacts. And the moment I do that, contacts have been applied. And in my pre-check, now I see that there is a green symbol. So it really tells me the study has all the information required to be to solve the problem now. Well, great. So I go on to solve it. I'm ready with all the elements that are needed, and I go on to solve it. And this is the part where I am talking whether we want to solve it locally or on the cloud. At this moment, perhaps I will rely on solving it locally. I'll tell you why. Because a problem which is a linear statics test requires the least amount of it is the least complex problem that can be solved, and it really doesn't require a lot of compute power. So it is essentially getting solved. And in a while, I will get to see the results. So this is all live. Yeah.
Sanjay, in the meantime, I think there's one, somebody noticed, is there any additional environment under you in a screen called as Nest, N-E-S-T?
Out here, yes.
Workspace. Yeah, I told them that this could be a plugin, but they were curious to know what is workspace. This Nest.
Is this well, the Nest or? Workspace is all about sheet metal nesting, and it is part yes. of Fusion. Absolutely. Right. So we can take a set of sheet metal objects and create a optimized nested sheet for you know, optimizing the wastage of material that might arise you know, when the spaces in between are not correctly utilized. This helps us reduce the wastage in manufacturing. That is what nesting is all about.
Absolutely. And the good thing is we are going to cover some part of this in tomorrow's session on laser cutting.
Fantastic. Yes. Great. So now coming back to the problem at hand, well, I see this, I'm not really concerned with the values right now. That is not the intent here. But if you have really used a plastic table or a plastic stool, and if it has become a little old, and when you're sitting on a plastic chair also, for example, I don't see a compression happening like this. As in, if I were to simply animate this, I don't see the behavior which is like this, and I would rather see that these legs will really spread on the ground. I, you know, I have experienced, and it can be sometimes really fatal or maybe lead to an accident if you are a little overweight for the chair that you're sitting on, and it has been not designed for a certain kind of weight. Just a side joke, but the fact that I'm trying to put across is that in real life, if I were to use linear static stress to solve this problem, this is not really going to give me the right result, because this is not how the deformation is going to really take place. So what is the right way basically to solve this problem is what I'm going to talk about. The right way to solve this problem is this. Let me create a new study. And the problem that we can, the real physics that I want to use to solve this problem here is structural buckling. So we'll soon see how this is different. So I'm sure I made my point when I gave the example of a chair that, you know, sometimes, you know, of course, now we have wooden chairs, but, you know, when I would just mention this as perhaps an anecdote. When I got into my job and was really married, you know, initially, those early days when I had not a great salary, I did not have a wooden table. So I brought this plastic dining set from a very well-known manufacturer. And those are the kind of tables and chairs I'm trying to refer to. You know, many of us do use that, but, you know, many of us even may not be using it. But if you got the point that I'm referring to, this is the kind of object that I am referring. And the problems for such kind of objects cannot be solved by linear static stress. It can be solved by something known as structural buckling. So how do I go about defining my structural buckling? The same sequence, but you'll see there's a small difference that I'm going to do. So yes, the material is something that I'm going to define, and it is absolutely the same way. So I'm going to select all, shift select. I'm going to select the material plastic again. And I'm going to say, okay, so the material applied. So if I were to look at the steady material, this is where I can see it. Each object here can have a different material. But we have chosen to apply plastic to all because this entire assembly is made of plastic components. Constraints, the same constraints, but we'll see a small difference going ahead. So this time I'm going to apply things a little differently and explain you why I'm going to do this. So I'm going to choose the same faces, but I'm not going to choose all this time. I'm going to choose one. I'm going to say okay. As I'm applying this, you'll see that you'll see that in the load cases, there's a section called loads and there's a section called constraints. And in the constraints, I just applied this fixed constraint. I'm just going to rename it as A for simplicity. I'm going to go to the next one. I'm going to again use the same command, which is constraint. I'm going to say okay. This time I'm going to name it B. I it's not necessary to name it, okay? It's absolutely not necessary. I'm just naming it for simplicity. Sometimes doing it, naming it, giving it specific names helps in identifying it when there are large number of objects out there with different things. So you can easily choose to edit specific objects by selecting them by their name. Again, for the third one, I say okay. Okay, I say okay out here. I say rename out here. Just go on to do rename it as C. And the last one out here. So the fourth constraint, okay, and D. Now I'm going to revisit each one of let me say okay, yeah, and D out there. Now let me just figure out and let me think a little, how is it the way a chair, plastic chair, behaves when someone overweight sits on it, or even a table for that matter, when you press too hard or keep something really heavy on a plastic, it really spreads out. So how do I really constrain to allow it to spread like that? Okay, so I'm going to perhaps go back and edit my constraints, and Here, what we have specified is we have specified that it is not able to move in all the three directions, that is X, Y, and Z. Now, why is the direction, if you look at the model correctly, why is the direction which is normal to the ground? So, Y definitely will have to be there every time because it is not going to penetrate the ground. So, I cannot allow it to move in the Y direction definitely. But I am going to allow it to move in one of the directions for this one. I am going to also allow it to move for this other one in the other direction. And this one, perhaps I'm going to leave it at Y. And this one out here, I'm going to, so I cannot have all the four elements totally moving in all directions because that's really almost impossible to solve. So I'll have to come keep one of the objects definitely fixed. So I'm going to keep this D out here completely grounded. So as in, you know, this is the grounding point and everything else is going to spread out in the various other directions. Well, that having done, now I want to apply a force specifically on that area that, you know, where I'm going to keep the maximum amount of load. So let me quickly go back. So I how can I do that? Let me show you how I can specify. So if I go to apply loads, there is no way in which I can apply it to a selected area. There is a way in the current scenario, the way the model has been defined, there is no way. So I'm going to make small changes to it. I'm going to go to design and I'm going to make a small change out here. So I'm going to create those two ellipses that were already there, but now let's say these two ellipses represent the footprint of the object that you are going to keep there. Okay, it could be, I don't know, I'm thinking loud. It could be a sewing machine kept on one side. It might have a certain weight. There could be a TV. You're not supposed to keep a TV on a plastic table, but let's say that is the kind of weight you want it to carry. So I only want it to give me results based on when I'm placing my objects in this area. So my boundary conditions are supposed to be in this area. So how am I going to do this? I'm going to create or split the face, that is this face, using this splitting tool. So I have to do it one by one out there. So I got this correctly. I go on to switch on the sketch again. I go on to say split face once more for the second ellipse. Now essentially what I have is a selectable area within that face. Let's go back to simulation and see how easy it is to move between various workspaces. You are absolutely there. You can choose to go back and forth n number of times till you have defined your problem correctly. So, yes, now I have everything defined. Nothing has changed out here. The things that I had already defined. Let's go on to specify a load. Now, either I have a load in kgs or I have in pounds. I am not sure. Of course, I do have in pounds. That is what I am aware of. And I know the value as well. But let's say someone were to give you the value in kgs. One is you, of course, convert it in pounds and you enter it in pounds. Why do I want to enter it in pounds? Because my current system of units is US. But in Fusion 360, at absolutely any time within the process, you are free to choose a different system of units. So it doesn't matter where you started, with what system of units you started. Unlike many others, solutions out there where, you know, the moment you define, a system of units, that you have to live with it till the end. Here, that is definitely not, I would say, a matter of concern, and I can choose to apply or change my system of units at any point in time. And as I have chosen US, and if I were to simply look at the units, my system of units for force is pound force. So the value that I'm going to enter now is that of 200 pound force. So, well, now let's look back. I have defined material, the physics type that I have chosen in structural buckling. I defined constraints, I have defined loads, and I have not defined contact. So that is what is being prompted out here. If I check on the degrees of freedom, it's all red. Again, something that I need to fix. I make use of automatic contacts, the same way I did in the earlier study out there. Well, it's green, ready for solving, and I go on to now solve the problem on the cloud. Well, which is the problem that I am solving? As I said, we can solve multiple problems at the same time, but here I only choose to solve one problem. So I could have defined multiple problems out there, and I could have said solve everything for me. It could be 10 problems, it could be 50 problems, it doesn't matter. And I go on to say solve on the cloud. Well, at this point, I can actually close my system and start working on a different tool. But yes, that's not the objective for us today. But that is what you can really do. You will be notified by email that your problem has been solved. And that is when you can click on the link in the email, or right now, since I am in the problem solving area itself, I can always go and figure out what's happening. So solve status, it tells me that the sending is complete and it is now solving the problem. And it is 54% complete. And it's almost 100% complete, and I have received it. So it has various stages. This was definitely very, very fast, I would say. And I have three buckling nodes. So if I were to see the one out here, and if I try to animate it, okay, let me make it normal. In fact, so various buckling modes, if I had chosen, of course, I did not talk about one thing. The number of modes that I had selected was three. Hence, I am seeing three results. For such kind of problem, perhaps three is a good number. But for other problems, we might choose a higher number to see the number of mode shapes. So this was a very, very quick example of how I can really solve one of the types of complex problem, and which might have taken definitely much more time for me to solve on my local machine. So Varun, I think this is what I definitely wanted to cover for the day. I'm not covering all the analysis types, but the objective was to expose the audience to where they can get started, where they can access the tools, and some salient features and elements of the Cloud Solve. And this is an example where I showed both a linear static solve, which really did not give me the right results, but how the structural buckling method gave me a realistic, more realistic result, and how I leveraged the cloud to solve it.
Right. I think it was a very insightful session. Thank you so much for that. And maybe we can quickly go to the questions. There are a couple of questions which we have answered. Participants, if you have more questions, this is the time, and we cannot get that answer. So please feel free to put your questions in the Q&A box. There's one question from Bhavarth. How do you apply fixed constraints of rotation about an axis?
Yes, absolutely. So we can absolutely apply all 6 degrees of freedom. What I only showed you was being able to apply the 3 linear degrees of freedom, but we can also specifically manipulate the rotational degrees of freedom as well. So that's possible. I'm not going to show you right now, but it's easy to find. Definitely, it's there. It's possible to apply.
Okay, how to select alloy materials, and is it even possible?
Well, any physical material here that we are defining is based on its physical characteristics. So alloys are generally composition of multiple elements put together to improve their physical characteristics. So what we need to have with us are those physical characteristics only. We don't need to know the composition of that alloy. So alloy or any other material for that matter is defined by its physical characteristics of Poisson's ratio, of density, and various other physical characteristics. That is what is required to be specified. We are not really concerned with what it is composed of.
Right. And I think this is also possible to define the custom material.
Yes, so we can definitely define a custom material. And when you are having an alloy, I'm sure you are also having its physical test results that have come to you from a laboratory, or you have your own sample lab where you have the tensile test, strength testing machine, and various other machines that can derive those physical characteristics. Those are the values that we require to even create a new material. So alloy or no alloy, we can create any kind of material with those physical characteristics.
Right. There's another question. How do we test on a disc brake of a bike or any other braking system in simulation workspace?
Well, we have, as I said, we can solve problems for with temperature inputs also. So we can solve multiple physics. So we can simulate. In fact, one of our standard classic examples that is out of the box in our simulation tutorials is that of a disc brake and how we are solving its problem of overheating. So yes, it can be solved. There are elements that we can specify in terms of temperature, friction, various parameters, and yes, those can be definitely solved. We in fact have just YouTube a video for the disc brake analysis on Fusion 360, and you will get the answer for yourself. It's a standard example that we have in our tutorials.
Right. How accurate are the simulations done on Fusion 360 as compared to ANSYS?
Well, as I said, Fusion 360 is based on Nastran. So just Google Nastran, N-A-S-T-R-A-N, and you really figure out what or how accurate the results are. It is absolutely a very robust solver. And I wouldn't compare it as in saying it's better or not better or that is not better. Even other softwares give accurate results. But the point I'm trying to emphasize is the name that you have used, they are definitely a well-known name in the industry, and the kind of results that they are able to give are definitely correct and useful for your functional requirements. At the same time, Nastran is something that has been proven. Everyone who learns analysis is exposed to Nastran, and that is the same solver that we are using. So absolutely comparable to, if I may say, ANSYS or any other known solver that you are familiar with.
Right. We have another question. Can we simulate the contact stress of gears or rack and pinion?
Yes, we can simulate. There are sliding contacts. There are sliding with penetration contacts. Yes, there are various kinds of contacts that can be simulated for a rack and pinion or even a set of spur gears for that matter. Yes, we can do that.
Right. And can we also add, how can we add mesh or mesh control?
Oh, interesting.
I think that's kind of automatic.
Sorry, unfortunately, I did not cover that.
Yeah.
I had an example which I could have shown, but we don't have that much time. We have ways to select geometry elements and apply mesh control. So not every part of the geometry. So let's say you do an analysis for the first time without really bothering about mesh control, size of the mesh. And you figure out this is the area which is probably more affected. But since I had not defined my mesh properly, the results may not be accurate. But I definitely come to know from my first analysis that these are the areas which are likely to have more stress concentration. Now I can go, I have a way in Fusion 360 where I can select that specific localized area and apply local mesh control so that I, when the computation happens, it really puts more effort in that localized area rather than trying to compute the entire problem with a very fine mesh. So yes, we can apply local mesh controls around features, around geometry.
Right.
I hope that answers the question. Yeah.
Right. If we change the ground condition, then is there any change in stress and buckling?
Well, no, there is no way to specify a ground condition here. The only way we are specifying that is by way of restricting the movement in a certain direction. You saw me specify the boundary conditions in such a way so that it could move in x direction but not move in z. It could move in z direction, right, but not move in y. So that is the way of restricting. So if I change those elements and reverse that, definitely the results will be different. Yes.
So from analysis data, how I know when material or object is broken and have to change material?
Well, the basics of interpreting an analysis result is by way of interpreting the values of stress, strain, and displacement. So, for example, for every material which has physical properties, it has a breaking value for the stress. Or a value at which, beyond which it leaves its linear behavior and goes into the plastic range. And specifically talking of metals. So, by looking at the value of the stress and comparing it with the value of the allowable stress of the applied material, you can figure out that this is likely to break in a certain area. So, this is a very common rule in any analysis. This is how we figure out that this particular area which shows a certain value of stress is likely to fail with this material because the allowable stress value for that material is less than the one that is computed in that area. So this is how we figure out whether perhaps an object is going to withstand or not.
Yeah. Can we do shape optimization even if we don't have symmetric component?
Absolutely, yes. And irrespective of the shape, irrespective of symmetry, we can definitely do shape optimization. And the symmetry doesn't really have much of a role to play. If there is a symmetry component, yes, the life is simplified and it's easy because we have to solve only the half of it. But if we have to solve the complete thing, we have the cloud here to help us to solve the problem very fast. So yes, we can solve irrespective of symmetry.
Can you please elaborate on the drop test which you mentioned in the PPT? What is it actually?
Well, in the drop test here, we are simulating a object falling on account of gravity from a given height and how it will land on a given surface. And when it lands and the area that it touches. So it is an event simulation, which means that the object, when it lands from height A to height 0, it is not going to happen in 0 seconds. It is going to happen in a certain amount of time. So it's an event. So we can simulate the event of that object falling from height A to height, I would say, 0, all the turns and twists that it is going to go through. And the moment it touches the ground, what is going to be the impact on the object? what are the shock waves that are going to go through it backwards, and are is it going to create stresses that will perhaps result in failure of that object? That is what we can simulate.
Right. Does decreasing mesh size increases internet data usage and solving time?
It doesn't definitely increase the internet data usage. Solving time, it will increase locally. On the cloud, it will increase minusculely, in a very small percentage. But yes, there will definitely be a little increase because there is more to solve out there.
Is it possible to simulate wooden material?
Yes, it is possible. Again, any material has a physical property. That is what a software uses to solve. So yes, it is possible to simulate material, physical wooden material.
First, I would like to thank Sanjeev. You gave a wonderful, insightful presentation. Thank you for your time. And here again. So tomorrow we have another session on laser cutting, and Just Robotics and Fusion 360 is a symbiotic relationship starting back in 2017. So Just Robotics is a Bangalore-based company who make education technology products, and they make robot kits for education purposes. Fusion 360 is their favorite tool, and when it comes to all the laser cutting requirements, and this session throws lights on the exact specific usage, limitations, benefits, materials, science, advantage, disadvantage of Fusion 360 with respect to Just Robotics. And once again, we are running this extended access program for cloud collaboration products. This is your chance to use these solutions for free of cost till June 30. And here I end this webinar. Thank you everyone for joining today. Really appreciate your commitment towards this course. It's going really, really awesome and great. We are all loving the questions you are proposing. Have a great day, and I'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Anand. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjeev. Thank you, Varun. Bye.